All right, well, today we are going to continue. We just started last week looking at Abram and Sarai, who would be renamed Abraham and Sarah. And we'll find out why in a little bit. But we are looking at Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Jacob and Leah and Rachel, the matriarchs and patriarchs of what became the nation of Israel. And we're looking at how it is that God called them. And this series is called An Imperfect Call, because they lived it out imperfectly, and they made many mistakes along the way. Now, last week's sermon was not about a mistake, it was about the call itself. God, who was a relatively new God to Abram, had called him to leave his homeland and to go to the promised land, the Canaan. And so he made a covenant with Abram, and here's what he said. He said, if you follow me and trust me, I will bless you, and you will have children, and their descendants will become very numerous, and through your descendants, the entire world will be blessed. So that's a pretty good deal. But that's the covenant or the promise that God made with Abram. And so Abram leaves town and heads towards the promised land, and he gets there. And so that's where we leave off. But now, in today's scripture reading, we learn that there is a famine in the land. We're not sure how much time has passed. Sometimes you don't know how much time has passed between one verse and another in the Bible. But there is a famine in the land, which means there's no food. Now, if we go through a drought or something like that, it's not as big of a deal anymore because we can have food shipped all over. You know, we have mass distribution. But back then, of course, if you had a famine, and in many places in the world today, if you have a famine, you have to leave. You have to leave and you have to go live somewhere else until the famine ends. And so Abram and Sarai had to leave and go to Egypt as refugee immigrants. And it's really interesting because that reminds us that when God calls us to something, even if we follow God's calling, it might not be leading us to a life of comfort and ease. As we know, Abram and Sarai, they got to the promised land, and I don't know how long it was, but then there's a famine and they have to leave, really? You know, they just got there. And sometimes, though, following God's call leads us to unfamiliar territory, even after we think we've already arrived. And so anyway, as Abram and Sarai are going to Egypt, he is worried. He is very worried because he's afraid that the Egyptians may find his wife attractive, and they may decide that they want to make her their wife, and then they may kill Abram to get her. Boy, what a thing to worry about, you know? And so he's not sure what's going to happen, but he hatches up this plot. He hatches up this plan. That what he's going to do is they are both going to tell people that they are brother and sister, not husband and wife. That way, you see, if an Egyptian wants her, they can take her to be his wife without having to hurt Abram. Sound like a good plan? Yeah. So they get to Egypt, and lo and behold, Abram is right. And but it's the Pharaoh, above all people, it's the Pharaoh that wants to have her as his wife. So they tell this story that they are brother and sister. And so the Pharaoh takes her as his wife. Actually, instead of hurting Abram, since he is the brother of this woman, the Pharaoh is very grateful to him. And so therefore, he blesses him and allows him to prosper in the land. And so Abram, as it says in verse 16, he acquires many animals and servants, i.e. slaves. But he gets many animals and people to work. And so he grows quite wealthy. And Sarai is, meanwhile, the Pharaoh's wife. And this went on for quite a while. Because it takes a while to grow this much wealth. These animals, these servants, everything. It takes a little while. Now, if this doesn't seem dark enough, we have to realize this is something I just thought of as I was preparing the sermon. I hadn't thought of this before. Abram probably didn't have any plan to get her back. He probably did not have, because when you think about it, how in the world would he do that? How in the world would he take away a wife of the Pharaoh, him being the brother and an immigrant? How in the world is he going to do that? I don't know. I don't know if he had in his mind a way that he was going to eventually do that, or if he just figured he was going to find someone else. I don't know. But this is a plan where he prospers at the expense of Sarah. Luckily, God intervenes. It says that the Pharaoh's household is afflicted with disease, and somehow the Pharaoh connects the dots. I'm not sure how, but he figures out that it's because Sarai is the wife of Abram. And so he summons Abram, and he rebukes him and says, "Why would you do this? Why would you do this?" And so now the Pharaoh's just scared. You know, he wants them out of there. And so he wants them both to leave. And really, though, the Pharaoh is pretty gracious to them because he lets Abram keep all of the wealth that he has accumulated. Maybe he didn't have to do that, but I think he just wanted to be kind to them so that things would go well in his own household, so that the disease would leave. And so Abram and Sarai then leave Egypt, and that's where we end the story for now. What an interesting story. One thing that we learn from this story is that the Bible is not strictly a children's book. And what we learn is that the Bible does not gloss over people's mistakes. And for Abram, or just about any other biblical character, if you read about them long enough in the Bible, you'll find some glaring mistakes that they make. So the question we have to ask is there anything redeemable about what Abram did? I would say no. We'll just lay it out there. No. There is nothing. You know, there are things that people do that are just not redeemable. You know, you can't say, "Well, that was good because," and then we take a twisty road here to try to figure out and rationalize why it's actually good. No, it was not. It was a mistake. It was wrong. It was self-centered. It was wrong. But we also have to remember there are a couple of different ways to think about this story. Number one, this is an ancient story. It took place a long time ago. Sometimes we like to think that the Bible times were kind of similar to our times, but I don't think that we really grasp how different things were. It was a long time ago. And people did things back then that we would consider atrocious today. Which really isn't a surprise. People do things today that we consider atrocious. But back then as well, they did things we consider atrocious today. This was a practice that was not just done once. Abram would do it again later. His son Isaac would do it once. And this was a practice that was known in Israel. I don't know how widely it was practiced, but it was done. To give Abram some benefit of the doubt, we do recognize that they were between a rock and a hard place. They were in a difficult situation, and there was no clear-cut answer. But nonetheless, his was a plan of self-preservation. Now, he may have been thinking, it may be possible that he was thinking that God's covenant required that he be alive, not necessarily his wife. Because God's call thus far, at the beginning of Genesis 12, involved him. It wasn't until later that God says, "No, it is through your wife Sarah that you will have the child of promise, not through anyone else." So it could have been that in Abram's mind, he needed to be alive for the promise, but it didn't necessarily involve Sarah. Doesn't make it any better, but that could have been what he was thinking. We don't know for sure. But one thing we learn is that he was looking out primarily for himself, whatever his motivations were. So, another thing that we need to remember and realize is that marriage back then was not based on love. That is a rather modern thing. Marriage was not based on love, it was based on the acquisition of property. In ancient marriage, women were viewed as being little more valuable than property. They were not seen as having the same level of intelligence as men. This should not be a surprise because for most of human history we've struggled with this, and women have only been able to vote in America for 98 years now. So we're making a lot of progress, but as we look back in ancient times, marriages oftentimes were done to acquire more children to work the land. So in an agricultural society, this is one reason why polygamy was quite popular in the old days, is that the more wives you had, the more children you have. The more children you have, the more people you have to work your land. Now, it wasn't just that. It's not like they didn't grow attachments to one another. But marriages were usually either arranged, it was for the acquisition of property, or it was for political gain. That's why many of the kings in the Old Testament have numerous wives from different countries, was to create political alliances so that different countries would be assured that they were not going to attack each other, but they would have an alliance and they would help one another. Who here is inspired this morning? Wow. That's depressing. But it's just reality. It's a part of our history, positive or negative. It's a part of our history. And we have to acknowledge that, but it can help inform us as we read some of these ancient stories. And so, what can we learn from this story? Is there anything that we can take from this story that is redeemable? I would say yes. What Abram did is dishonorable, but what we can learn from it can be redeemable. Two things. Number one, one thing that we learn is not to do as Abram did, right? And you say, well, yeah, I'm not going to do that. That's not what I'm talking about specifically. But what I mean is that we want to make sure that we treat all people as human beings of equal worth. We want to make sure that we're not denigrating anyone or making them out to be less than human. Because any kind of religion that somehow rationalizes or legitimizes the dehumanizing of any kind of person for whatever reason is a religion that the world would be better off without. And if we seek to dehumanize other people, then we want to make sure we're not claiming to follow Jesus, because if we do, we're going to be dragging the name of Jesus through the mud. So we want to make sure that we follow Jesus' teaching, which is that all people are made in the image of God. And even if they don't know God, they're still made in the image of God, and they're creations of God, and they're still valuable. And so that's one thing that we can take from this. The second thing that we can take from this is we can learn that, you know what, in spite of Abram's mistake, in spite of what he did, God still used him. You know, God still used him. And God told him later on, no, it's through your wife Sarah. You can hear him sighing. But he's like, no, it's through your wife Sarah that the child of promise is going to be born. Come on. And then so, you know, he continued to use Abram, and Abram, who became Abraham, what do most people remember him for? That most people don't remember him for this story. Most people remember him as being the father of three great religions in the world. Most people remember Abraham, as Paul said in Romans, as believing in God, and God credited it to him as righteousness. Most people remember Abraham for having a strong faith and doing what God called him to do. There were blunders along the way for sure, as we just saw in today's text. Like I said, if you read any biblical character long enough, you're going to be shocked. You know, Moses and David were murderers, you know, if we think Abram was so bad. But God used them. God used these people to do wonderful things. And I think that the world is a better place because of them, even though they made these very hard to understand decisions at times. And that's encouraging for us, because you know why? Because, first of all, show of hands, who hasn't made a mistake? We're going to wait here until somebody... No, we'd be here a long time, because we've all made mistakes, we've all done bad things, we've all made bad decisions, we have all had times in our life when we would say we were not the best version of ourselves, right? Romans 3:23 says we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but we don't really need a scripture verse to tell us that. We know it intrinsically. Most people know that intrinsically through their own experience, if they spend any time in reflection. They can say, yeah, I made some bad choices there. Or, yeah, I wasn't the best version of myself there. I should have said that differently. Or I should have done that differently. You can fill in the blanks from your own life. But we know that we've all been there. We've all made bad decisions. And yet God can still use you. God can still use us to do great things. It doesn't nullify God's call. If what Abram did nullified God's call in his life, we'd be done with this sermon series today, right? But it's going to go on for a while, because Abram, God wasn't done with Abram, and God says, nope, this is bad, I'm going to pluck you out of this. So he got them out of there, but But he continued on. This is not Abram's last mistake. It's not. And you probably have not made your last mistake in life either. But nonetheless, God is going to continue on with Abram, and Abram is indeed going to complete his call. Even if there are some blunders and mistakes along the road, even if he is imperfect, in fact, far from perfect, he's going to complete his call. And regardless of the mistakes you may have made, God is still calling you. And it doesn't matter the mistakes you've made or what may come. God can still use you. You can still be an instrument of God's will and peace in the world. So let us be encouraged by that fact, that God can still use you no matter what.